I found in my files, about 20-something years ago, I had found the list of 12 steps for Al-Anon. Actually, they came out of Minneapolis, Minnesota, and I had saved them all these years, over 20 years I had had them. And that was part of the inspiration to put the message together today. You know, I was listening to David Jeremiah this morning really early, and the choir was great. And there was a group that was singing, and the lady, the lead singer, a lady singer, was singing a song that I had never heard before. But I picked up some of the words that I thought were, to me, very, very important. And part of those words of this song that I had never heard said, "We are survivors of the storms." And that really stuck with me. And I see ourselves, at least I see myself, as a survivor of storms, ups and downs, and ins and outs, and failure. Don't you wish you could go back a number of years ago and you could relive or you could change some things in your life? Every one of us probably could do that. And when we've had difficulties, when we've had failure, when we've had sadness, when we've had losses, when we've had storms in our life, it's not easy to deal with some of those things and get up and keep going. It's not easy. It's difficult. And the enemy comes and tries to bring up our past and tries to hinder our future because of our past. And I just thought that was such a neat phrase in that song. We are survivors of storms and failures and difficulties and hard places, hard things, sorrowful things. We're here today. We have survived and we love God. And we want to continue to go forward in faith and trust in God. Amen? And let me go over these 12 steps. I've had people over the years that have gone to Al-Anon, or Alcoholics Anonymous, it stands for. And I believe that they have been helped and blessed by an organization that focuses in on their particular addiction. And I believe some of the principles here, these were over 20 years ago that were written out. I don't know if they've become more politically correct, so I'd kind of like to compare what some of the steps are now compared to over 20 years ago. We admit that we're powerless over alcohol, that our lives have become unmanageable. I think we can find some of these principles in the Bible as this is an honest look at ourselves, which is very important. I come to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. I believe the Bible teaches restoration, amen? Make a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understand Him. Now, there is such a thing as repentance, and reliance on God is a principle in the Scriptures. Amen. Make a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. How many times as a Christian have you had to take an honest look at yourself and do inventory of your life? I think we've all done that. That inward conviction that we have experienced. Number five, admit to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. We believe the Bible teaches confession, and we have done that as well. Number six, we entirely readily have to have God remove all of our defects of character. How many believe the Bible teaches redemption? They may not say it quite that way, but it is a principle of redemption. We humbly ask him to remove our shortcomings. I think we prayed that in different ways. Number 8, make a list of all persons that we have harmed or become willing to make amends to all people. Restitution's in the Bible, right? Number 9, make direct amends to such people wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. I think we understand the sensitivity in seeking forgiveness of people for ourselves and for others. Number 10, continue to take personal inventory when we were wrong, promptly and admit it. I think the Bible teaches us that we need to take ownership of our lives and our experiences. Number 11, sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understood him, praying only for knowledge of his will for us and the power to carry that out. I think the Bible teaches us we pray for God's will and wisdom for our lives. Amen. Number 12, having a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, we try to carry out this message to others and practice these principles in our affairs of life. And obedience is in the scriptures. We learn to follow a path of obedience to, and we're blessed by that obedience that we carry out. So I do see the value of these steps that people have gone through to find help for their lives. I believe there may be limitations with things of this nature, but I believe it is a valid program for people to find help for themselves. And I do believe many have found help through these programs. But I sort of put together my 12 steps today in the scriptures that I think is real clear. I call them divine principles for successful living and victory. 12 biblically based principles for victorious living. Let's ask the Lord to really speak these words to our hearts today. Father, we thank you for your word that will abide forever. Anoint your word today to our ears and to our hearts, and make these principles and these concepts real to us today. And we are very careful to give you all the praise and all the glory. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Divine principles for successful living and victory. How many want to have victory in your life? I believe that is something we all desire. Successful living and victory. Victorious living. At the top of my list, not that one is necessarily more important than the other, I just started out right with prayer without ceasing. We must pray without ceasing. I like 1 Thessalonians 5:17. Pray without ceasing, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning all of us. Amen? We should pray about everything. 1 Timothy chapter 2, 1 through 4, talks about prayers and intercessions. He says, I exhort supplications and prayers, intercessions, and of giving thanks being made for all men, kings and all in authority, may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. We give our lives to prayer. We pray about everything. We pray without ceasing. Luke 18:1 says, Jesus gave this parable. Men ought to always pray. Don't lose heart and don't give up and don't stop praying, is what he teaches us. I think if we're going to have victorious living, we have to pray about everything. Anything and everything. The attitude of prayer is always in our hearts. It's always on our lips. Driving down the road, we think about a lot of things. But the attitude of prayer should always be there. Pray without ceasing is a very important principle for success. I had a friend of mine that was driving down the road, and God pointed out a house that he's a businessman. God began to deal with him, and he began to pray, and God began to speak to him. And God said, go buy that house, and go buy it right now. And he went to where the name of the realtor, and went and actually bought the house right then. Because he was talking to God, and God said, go buy the house. Well, to make a long story short, while he was buying the house, the city fathers was having a meeting, and they were zoning that property business. At the same time, he was buying it. And it became very valuable an hour later, after he bought it. Extremely valuable. And it became a house of ministry. Listen, God speaks to people through prayer. It's important to pray and always be in an attitude of prayer. Sometimes we may be thinking about a lot of other things, but God help us to have an attitude of prayer. And I like Luke 18:1. Men should pray, not lose heart, but keep on praying. Don't give up. Keep on praying. The second principle, dwell richly in the Word. How many believe that will give you victory in your life? If you dwell richly in the Word. I like Colossians 3:16. He said, let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your heart unto the Lord. Dwell richly in the Word, whereby the Word just begins to flow out of you. You'll find yourself going down the road just singing the Word. You know, you may not be a songwriter, but if you'll dwell in the Word, it'll just come right out of you, like music, amen? Dwell richly in the Word. Acts 17:11 says, receive the Word like the Bereans, with readiness of mind, eager to see and understand the Word of God. The Bereans were people who were very eager to accept the message of Jesus Christ. I love that. This is not on your outline, but 1 Peter 2:2-3. As newborn babes, desire sincere milk of the Word, that ye may grow. The Word is life-sustaining, amen? The Word is spiritual growth. Spiritual growth is predicated upon the knowledge of His Word. Grow. Be like the Bereans. God called them noble people. Noble. Would you like for God to call you a noble person? He called the Bereans noble because they were eager and ready always to receive the Word of the Lord. Pray without ceasing is a good step towards victory. Dwell richly in the Word. And number three, rejoice continually. Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. We don't rejoice and praise God for everything. We praise Him in everything. We don't praise Him for bad things, but we praise Him in the difficult things of life. Though He slay me, yet will I trust Him, Job said. Pray, dwell, rejoice, in the Lord. I like John 15:11. He says, "These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, that his joy might remain in us through everything." I like Kay Warren, who wrote a book called Joy. She says, joy is a choice. You have to choose it. And as you choose joy, God will flood your soul with joy. Pray that his joy might remain in us. In 2 Corinthians 6:10, he says, sorrowful yet always rejoicing. Sorrowful yet always rejoicing. Inner triumph, inner praise through tears. As poor yet making rich. As having nothing yet possessing all things. If one is saved, you have everything. If you know the Lord, you have everything. If you're born again, you have everything. There's nothing that you are lacking. If you have the Lord. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want anything else. Amen? A little 11-year-old girl, one of my churches, she said, the Lord is my shepherd. I just don't need anything else. She was so sweet. 11 to 10 years old, something like that. I said, yes, she needs to go preach next Sunday. That girl does. Pray. Dwell in the Word. Rejoice. Another good step for victory is you got to fight. How many knows you got to fight? The good fight of faith. It's very important that we fight the good fight of faith. 1 Timothy 6:12. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto you are called and have professed a good profession before many witnesses. The fight that we're called to fight is the fight of spiritual warfare. Amen? God hasn't called us to fight one another, right? He called us to fight spiritual warfare. Fight the good fight of faith. Amen? 1 Timothy 1:18. Paul said to Timothy that you might war a good warfare in the army of King Jesus. Amen? How many know we've been drafted into an army? And we have been called to be soldiers of the cross. We have been called to fight the good fight of faith. Amen. 1 Peter 5:8-9 says, be sober, self-controlled, vigilant, awake, watchful, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour. We do have a powerful adversary. But 1 John 4:4 says, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Amen? Yes. If we resist him and be strong in faith, we will find him fleeing from us. Amen? Okay. This is my 12-step program. How many like this 12-step program? Pray without ceasing. Dwell richly in the Word. Rejoice to God continually. That means even in difficult times, rejoice unto the Lord. Fight the good fight of faith. Listen, the Christian life is not some kind of Arabian magic carpet that we're just floating away to heaven, you know? You got to stand up as a soldier of Christ, and you've got to fight the good fight of faith. And you've got to fight the enemy who comes to kill, steal, and destroy, John 10:10. You've got to fight him. And you fight him not with flesh and blood, but with principalities. We fight him with the blood of Jesus Christ, because we're fighting against principalities and powers and rulers in dark places. How many knows that a lot of things this day and time has seemed to have gone to the dark side? I mean, whether it's the arts, whether it's Hollywood, whether it's politics, everybody seems to be going to the dark side. How many thinks it's time to stand up for the light? Yeah. and walk in the light as he is the light, and we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin and unrighteousness. Pray, dwell, rejoice, fight. And we've been called to maintain good works. How many believe God called you to good works? Titus 3:8. This is a faithful saying, and it's trustworthy. And these things I will that you affirm constantly, that which I have believed in God, and be careful to maintain good works. Be profitable. Maintain good works. 1 Thessalonians 4:11. And that you study to be quiet. Well, that's interesting. That you study to be quiet. That's the opposite of being seen and heard. I guess you know that. And to do your own business and to work with your own hands as we have commanded you. Shall I read that again? And that you should study to be quiet and to do your own business and to work with your own hands. How many knows God has called us to do good works? And sometimes we probably need to talk a little less and work a little more. Or either let our work match our talk, one or the other. Ed knows, us guys, we've been around people who can talk a good game. But when it comes to producing, it's a little different, right? God not only wants us to be able to talk about it, but he wants us to actually do it, right? 1 Thessalonians 15:58. Therefore, my beloved brother, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, and you know that your labor is never in vain in the Lord. Somebody say amen. Amen. Anything you do for the Lord, I don't care what it is, it's never in vain. God keeps good books, and you will be rewarded for all that you do for him. He will not forget it. Listen, you got to pray without ceasing. You got to dwell richly in the word. Rejoice continually. Fight the good fight of faith. Maintain good works. That's where it's at. Now, number 6 on our stepping stones to victory. You got to get your thinking right. We as Christians, if we're not careful, we can have some stinking thinking. And we got to get rid of that stinking thinking, right? That negative thinking. I like what he says in Philippians 4:8. Whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest and just and lovely, and things that have a good report, think about these things. Listen, you got to get rid of the negative and put on the positive. Amen? Think on these things, he said. Think on good and positive things. Ephesians 4:27 says, neither give place to the devil. Give him no opportunity. You must not give the devil even a little bit. Someone said, if you give him an inch, he thinks he's a ruler. You get that? Okay. I know it's corny, but it's true. Give him just a little bit, and he thinks he's the ruler of everything. Don't give the place to the devil. I put it in your notes. No opportunity. Give him no opportunity. No foothold. No loophole for him to have. Listen. God inhabits the praises of his people. Do you believe that Psalmist David said that? God inhabits the praises of his people. I was so excited as Brother Ed was leading us today. I was loving the praising God. Didn't you love it? God inhabits that. But Satan inhabits our complaints. God inhabits our praises. But when we start getting down in the mouth, and we start complaining, and we get into a negative run, Satan just moves right in on that and makes things worse. Don't you think so? Victorious living has to do with think on good and positive things. And 1 Peter 2:1, rid yourself. Everybody say, rid yourself. Therefore, of all ill will, all deceitfulness, malice, hypocrisy, insincerity, jealousy feelings, all backbiting, slander of every kind. Get rid of the negative. How many says, I'm going to join me today? Let's get rid of the negative. How many say we're going to do that? Let's get rid of it. Get rid of it. It has no place. Now, how many is feeling good about your steps you're taking? You're going to pray. You're going to dwell richly in the Word. You're going to rejoice. How many is going to rejoice continually? How many is going to fight as a good soldier of the cross? Warfare. Maintain good works. Think on good and positive things. How many like number 7? Stay filled with the Spirit. Somebody say amen. Ephesians 5:8, be filled with the Spirit. In the Greek, it is the ever-filling. Be ever-filled with the Spirit is the idea of the Greek. Ephesians 3:19 says that we might be filled with all the fullness of God. Fullness. Let me say fullness of God. What it's saying is be filled with God Himself. Be filled with God Himself. Filled with all the fullness of God. Listen, I like Ephesians 3:19, fullness, and then 2 Corinthians 9:8, overflowing. So you have fullness in 3:19 of Ephesians and 2 Corinthians, which is not on your sheet, which I added later. God is able to give you overflowing fullness measure. How many want to have fullness and you want it to run over? Now, my father always used to say, God not only wants to fill your cup, He wants to keep pouring and just runs over it, down into your saucer part. It sits on the cup down in the saucer, so you just keep pouring, and then your cup and your saucer is running over with fullness, right? Fullness, overflowing measure. The picture of the believer in the New Testament. If you want to find a picture of the believer in the New Testament, it is the overflowing, the overfilled cup, and not the half-filled. It's the overflowing, the overfilled cup is the picture of the believer in the New Testament. Okay. How many thinks that God wants to fill us with the Holy Spirit? Another good step for our Al-Anon program here is you got to be a giving person. Giving of your time, your talents, your resources. Giving liberally. Malachi 3:10 says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse that you may be have meat in my house, and prove me this day. Wherein saith the Lord, that I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings you cannot be able to contain. How many would like to have so much blessing you just couldn't contain it all? If we, and I put in the notes here, if we bring our gifts and our tithes to the Lord, we will receive an overflowing. And we don't bring to receive, but it's just the results of giving to God. And Proverbs 19:17, this is a good verse of scripture, and I don't like this one. It says, honor the Lord with your substance and the first fruits, but he goes on to say that if we are kind to the poor, in verse 17 of Proverbs 19, you're lending to God. If you're kind to the poor, you're lending it to the Lord. That's pretty powerful. I know we struggle. I know we struggle. We want to help people that need help. We don't want to give to people that are going to abuse Well, because we want to save what we're giving to people as a legitimate gift of giving help. We don't want to give to someone. I know we try to be discerning. We really want to help people that are people that we feel like are genuine, have genuine needs in their lives. And we struggle. So you're like me. You see people every day. Well, is this person? And so, some of you have said to me, well, I just go ahead and give it and let the Lord, you know, worry about whatever, whether it was a legitimate need or not a legitimate need. And that's one way to look at it. But I think we like sometimes, we would like for our gift to go somebody that really needed that gift that we're giving. But the Lord says, he who is kind to the poor lendeth to God. According to his gift, God will repay you or him. Think about that now. As we give out to other people, to help other people, you're giving it somewhat like unto God as a lender. How many knows that God pays his bills? Do you believe that? So as we give to those in need, we're like lending it to the Lord. And how many knows he pays great interest and he pays great rewards? I believe this is very important. If we're going to be victorious people, I do believe God wants to make us giving people. Loving freely, number 9. By this, all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. How many believe that love is important? By this, all will know if you have love one for another. 1 Peter 4:8, and above all things, be fervent in your love among yourselves. One Amplified Bible says, intense, unfailing in your love for one another. Wouldn't it be great if our love for one another became so intense, so incredible? 1 John 2:10, he that loveth his brother abideth in light, lives in the light. Let me read that again. 1 John 2:10. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, or he lives in the light because of your love for your brother. And you know Matthew 5:43-48. Love your neighbor. Love your enemies. Love them that curse you. Love becomes a spiritual maturity that is revealed in us by our love. Okay, pray, dwell, rejoice, fight, maintain, think on good things positively, stay filled with the Spirit, give liberally, love freely. And the last 3, grow, forgive, and witness. Grow consistently.